The Pleiadian Mission, A Time of Awareness. Part 5. The History of Man. During my stay at the Semjase Silver Star Center, my home was a small van parked behind the house with just enough room for myself and a very poor translation of Billy's contact notes in English. Someone had tried to translate them from German, but whoever it was did not speak English very well. The translation was word for word, as if someone had simply used a dictionary to look up all of the words without regard for grammar or sentence structure. This made the contact notes very hard to read, so I spent a lot of time trying to figure out what they said. The little van I was staying in was only a short walk from the main house and afforded me a little privacy, so I had a place to contemplate all that I was learning. I spent several hours each day going over the contact notes and then spent some time working around the farm and helping out since there was always some work to do, painting the garage or fixing a fence. My nights were normally filled with occupying some FIGU members' time with lots of questions, or reading and thinking. Usually in the afternoon I would spend some time with Billy, if he was up to it. He had a couch on the front porch where he liked to sit and enjoy the beautiful scenery that surrounded him. Just in front of the house he had built a small aviary that contained a few birds that would hop from branch to branch, chirping continuously as if they were very busy doing something. It was kind of hypnotic and tranquil to watch them playfully fly around the cage. Often I would sit there with him feeling the serenity of nature and soaking up the warm summer of Switzerland. I was learning a great deal from Billy and the other FIGU members who lived at the center. I had been reading my rather poor English version of Billy's contact notes that he had made during his meetings with Semjase, and I was trying to figure out the chronology of Earth history. Unfortunately, the notes were hard to read, with fragments of history scattered throughout the 1,800 pages. In hopes that Billy had a more cohesive understanding of all of this data, I asked him to fill in some blanks for me, and I finally got a better picture of what had happened here on Earth during the past several hundred thousand years. The history of man. One of man's greatest mysteries is his origin. Where do we come from, and why are we here on Earth? The history of our current civilization has been recorded fairly well, so we have a pretty good idea of what has happened the past 6,000 years or so, at least as far as major events such as wars and religious occurrences. But if you wanted to get into a discussion about any possible life existing here before that time, you would be hard-pressed to find any tangible materials to back up your argument. In order to put together the pieces of our past, we have the writings of the Bible, which are widely accepted by many. We also have the Sanskrit scrolls, a collection of writings that date back to around 1200 BC, and contain the religious wisdom of the East. We also have the highly regarded Mayan calendar, a prophetic work that has accurately portrayed the future of man from 2,000 years ago up to a time in the future around the year 2050. And, of course, there are the Dead Sea Scrolls, a collection of ancient manuscripts discovered in 1947 in a series of caves on the west bank of the Dead Sea in the area of Jordan. These scrolls are biblical religious texts written in Hebrew and Aramaic around 200 BC. The Pleiadians regard the Dead Sea Scrolls, the Mayan calendar, and the ancient Sanskrit scrolls as the most accurate representation of our past because they have not been changed or altered over the centuries. They say the Bible has been tampered with on too many occasions by power and religious groups and is no longer accurate. All of these great historical documents give us small glimpses into our immediate history, but none of them can give us much of a clue about any previous civilizations that may have existed here during the past millions of years. It is generally considered that our civilization is about 6,000 to 8,100 years old, depending on who you talk to. The Pleiadians tell us that the Earth is several billion years old and the universe is trillions of years old, certainly enough time for many civilizations to have come and gone. Of course, you will get many disagreements from scientists about how old, big, or long anything is because we simply do not have the technology to understand it all. Most of history is compiled from old records or some form of scientific dating scheme, such as carbon dating. But how could we tell if beings from other worlds have ever set foot here and had an effect on our development? Since the Earth has been able to support human life for at least a billion years, it's quite possible that there could have been many different civilizations that have come and gone. If the planet had changed orbit, rolled over on its axis, or met with natural disasters of different types, then any traces of these past societies may be under the ocean or buried miles under the ground. It is interesting that every now and then someone comes up with some unexplainable object or event, like a glass bottle buried in a tomb in Mexico that should be over 10,000 years old, or a mechanical device found in the ocean that obviously was made by some form of intelligence, but is unrecognizable. How about the report from an American university that summarized that the Earth must have been hit by a major asteroid or meteorite of some type around 10,000 years ago with a force sufficient enough to change the planet's axis, flood all of northern Africa, including Egypt, and ruin the atmosphere for years? Those were the conclusions of a team of scientists from studies of debris found in the floor of the Mediterranean Ocean. The Pleiadians are a very old race with information about many different civilizations going back 22 million years. Since our forefathers were also their forefathers, they have on file every language that has been spoken on Earth for thousands of years, as well as information of the history of man. Now that the knowledge of the Pleiadians is available to us, we can walk through our past and for the first time learn the fascinating truth about the development of man on Earth. 22 million BC, ancient Lyra. To begin with, in the constellation of Lyra we find the origin of man dating back as far as Pleiadian history extends. Here on these ancient planets are the ancestors of the oldest known form of human life of which they are aware. 22 million years ago ancient Lyran travelers first came into our system and built a colony. Since these were among the first attempts at space travel for them, it took a long time to reach Earth. When they arrived, they recorded the existence of very primitive human beings here. They found that Earth was a planet where human life had naturally developed over the course of evolution, but it was currently in a very primitive state. The Earth humans were a brown-skinned race who barely possessed any powers of reasoning or intellect and were of no concern to the celestial visitors. Over the course of the next few thousand years, many expeditions were made to Earth, resulting in a variety of colonies being formed for short periods of time. The ancient Lyrans were titans, standing 20 to 30 feet tall, from a planet much greater in size than ours. They were white-skinned, with blonde hair, usually had blue eyes, and had a lifespan of around 2,000 years. They were a warlike race that had not only developed technically, but were quite advanced in the use of spiritual power. They moved their warlike forces around the galaxy and used their great power to take control of many thousands of lesser developed races. Over the years, the Lyran bloodline was mixed with other civilizations, creating many different colors and races which spread throughout the galaxy. Just as their race was at its highest peak of advancement, a huge, destructive comet that became known as the Destroyer Comet found its way into the Lyran family of planets, and two-thirds of their race were killed. Along with the destruction, their technology was wiped out, and they were unable to continue to exercise control over the great empire they had built. The Great Lyran Empire had degenerated back to one planet with no technology to speak of. They were barely able to survive and were faced with the task of rebuilding a civilization which once dominated thousands of other worlds. After thousands of years, the Lyrans restored their society and again became a dominant force in the galaxy. Pleiadian history documents that he Lyrans went through a series of civilizations over a period of several millions of years. It was their pattern to rise to power, begin to fight among themselves, and then degenerate into a primitive society and start all over again. On some occasions their wars were so brutal that it took millions of years for them to recover from the primitive state left by the destruction. 387,000 BC, the first settlement on Earth. It wasn't until 387,000 BC, that the Lyrans once again had an effect on Earth. Another war had ravaged Lyra, and many of those on the losing side had fled for safety. They traveled through the cosmos and came to Earth as a place of sanctuary. It was peaceful here, the local humans were primitive and offered no resistance to their high technology. It was decided they would stay and build a colony. Back home in Lyra, it was discovered that a large group had fled to Earth, and ships were dispatched to come after them. Upon arriving at Earth, they were disgusted and appalled to find the conditions that prevailed here. The local Earth humans were being used as slaves and were being mistreated badly. Many were being used in experiments where they were being mated with animals, while others were being disfigured, raped, or maimed. The colony was an example of the darkest side of man. Living in degeneration and filth, it was decided to leave the colony on Earth, take away all of their technology, including their spaceships, and leave the 144,207 Lyran soldiers to their own fate on Earth. This colony died out after several thousand years, and the spirits of the Lyran soldiers that were left behind became part of the spirit world of Earth. The 144,207 degenerate Lyran soldiers would now be incarnating here along with the original inhabitants. The effect they would have on Earth would forever steer it away from a normal evolution. Lyran history continued to repeat itself for thousands of years until, after restoring themselves once again to a high level of technology, they built flight machines with beam drives and once again moved out into the cosmos. Their leaders were great scientists with an understanding of spiritual power, so once again they began to conquer other races. Their leaders soon realized the unlimited powers of the spiritual forces and developed them until they became masters of these great forces, becoming known as an Ishwish, IHWH, meaning God or King of Wisdom. The great power of their spirit allowed them to live for thousands of years, and they ruled over countless civilizations. The Ishwish leaders ruled with cruel power, and eventually the public started a civil uprising. The war lasted for almost four centuries, causing the death of more than 60% of the population and nearly destroying the three worlds of the Lyra system. It seemed that no one in the Lyra systems would escape this slaughter that raged 230,000 years ago. 228,000 BC, the flight from Lyra to the Pleiades and Ishwish named Asael could see the end coming and fled from the wars with 360,000 people in 183 great spaceships, capable of transporting over 1,000 passengers each, and 250 small space reconnaissance ships that could carry a crew of three. This group of Lyrans wandered through space for many years until they came across a star system with 254 still young, blue suns. There were already a few colonized planets with primitive people living there, but they were no threat to the great Lyran technology. They landed and built their new society on three different planets around a star they called Tegeta. Life was hard and difficult, and it took 300 years or their civilization to grow and adapt to their new environment. Millions of Lyrans fled the Great Wars and settled in Orion, Hyades and the Pleiades. After the new civilization developed, Asael commanded that they start to explore and conquer other worlds again, just as they had done in Lyra. The powerful beam drive ship sped out into open space and once main established a reign of tyranny over planets of less developed beings and brought them under their control. It was during this time that they came into the system known as the Hesperides. A young, underdeveloped form of human life was there and was quickly conquered and fell under Asael's rulership. The Lyrans once again were exercising their power over others and beginning to force their rule throughout the galaxy. It seems that the forces of greed and power were inbred well into the Lyrans, considering that peace seemed to escape them time after time. There had been millions of years of bloodshed and wars, and still they had not learned to get along peacefully with other races. The ancient Lyrians split off to Orion, Hyades, and the Pleiades and started new colonies. The planets of the Pleiades soon flourished and spread out to Earth, Mars, Hesperides, and Ulona. 226,000 BC. The time of Pleia. 70 years of conquering had diminished Asael's lust for power, and his life of bloodthirsty rule came to an end as the father of the Pleiades passed away. Control of the new race of the Pleiades fell to his daughter Pleia, an Ishrish, the female form of an Ishwish, who, like her father, had the blood of a warrior. Eager to build their great society even farther, the ordered the exploration ships to again seek out new worlds that could fall under her rule. As the ships moved out into space once again to explore, they came across the trail of the destroyer comet which so many years ago had been the destructive force that had ended the Lyran Empire. Contained within the tail of the great comet, they discovered debris from the planets of ancient Lyra. It was decided to follow the comet for a while and study its path of violence. This was the destructive force that had changed the history of Lyra and caused death on thousands of worlds, and now it had brought the warriors from the Pleiades into a small sun system and the home of a little planet called Earth. 225,000 BC. Earth is discovered again. To their surprise, they discovered a small group of uncivilized people living there. Some were brown-skinned and could be traced to the origin of life on Earth. Others were of mixed color, but most were white-skinned and had a Lyran spirit form. The Pleiadians had stumbled onto a colony founded by their ancient Lyran ancestors who had degenerated into a primitive society. Awed by their discovery of human life and common ancestry, it was decided to colonize three different planets in the system and continue the family chain. News of their discovery was sent back to the home planets and apparently sparked an interest in Pleia, for she ordered a great migration to be undertaken. Within a very short time, thousands of travelers from Ti Pleiades came and created societies on Earth, Mars, and Melona. Melona was a planet which existed beyond the orbit of Mars at that time. It was only a few short years before a small war raged on Earth, and many of the scientists left to return to the Pleiades, leaving the three planets to grow on their own. Pleia was unhappy with this and did not want her new colonies to be destroyed, so she dispatched a fleet to stop the war, and things calmed down again. 196,000 BC, war breaks out on Earth. In the home planets, the reign of Pleia came to an end, and the people of the Pleiades fell into dark times as they ruined their great society in war. The three planets of Earth, Mars, and Melona then existed without leadership or more than 30,000 years, which was a remarkably long time for Lyrans to get along with each other. It seems that some measure of evolution was finally happening on Earth. After returning their own civilization to a high level of advancement, the scientists of the Pleiades occasionally looked in on Earth and watched as technology there had also developed to a high state. Unfortunately, the men of Earth started to turn against each other. As the wars broke out on Earth, the leaders of the home planets decided once again to involve themselves and send a fleet to put a stop to it. Earth had degenerated into such an unruly society that it was decided to evacuate the planet and return their people to their home planets. The colonies on the planets of Melona and Mars had remained peaceful, they had taken no part in the war that raged on Earth, so were left alone by the forces that came from the home planets. The fighting spirit of Lyra did not lay dormant too long, though, for it only took 40 years before the people of Melona fell into war and destroyed the entire planet in a great explosion. The huge blast pushed Mars out of its orbit, causing complete destruction of all life there, and moved the planet into a new orbit. All that remains of ancient Melona is the debris of their planet, which is now called the asteroid belt. Once again, the Lyran fighting spirit had caused the destruction of two planets and brought death to millions. 116,000 BC, Earth is on its own. Over the next 80,000 years, many attempts were made at small colonizations, but none lasted. Earth was left alone with no help from the home planets, for the Pleiadians had too many problems of their own and had no interest in the small colonies that still existed on Earth. As time went by, the little blue planet was thought so little of that on many occasions, groups of renegades were expelled there. It even served as a prison colony for a while. Earthman has not developed naturally because of genetic engineering by our celestial fathers. 58,000 BC, the Great Plan. Societies had come and gone in the Pleiades, for the old Lyrans could never seem to get along for more than 10,000 years without going to war. Finally, 60,000 years ago, at a point of high population and technology, they decided once again to colonize the Earth. A great exodus occurred as hundreds of great spaceships with thousands of people came and built up a civilization which would last for 10,000 years. It was a great time for Earth, and the wars in the Pleiades seemed to be left behind. Large cities were built that reflected the advanced thinking and knowledge of a race with a legacy of millions of years. All the continents of Earth were inhabited, and man was living in harmony with himself and the planet. It was almost 10,000 years before the great society began to quarrel and fight among themselves. This time it was the scientists who were the cause of it. They wanted to take control and rule through the hand of material technology instead of spiritual awareness. The technology was so advanced that weapons had been designed that represented a new level of expertise, even for the Lyrans. This war was so devastating that it annihilated almost all life forms on Earth and erased every trace of their existence. It brought on a period when savages roamed the Earth and once again lived in primitive villages. The spirits of the original 144,207 Lyrans who came to Earth thousands of years before, plus all those who had died since, were sleeping on the other side. 48,000 BC, Pelagon, the first god on Earth. For several thousand years the earth was a dormant place of scattered tribes. Meanwhile, a great war was raging on the three home planets in the Pleiades. One of the great Pleiadian leaders of the time, who had captured the hearts of many, was a man named Pelagon. He was one of the more powerful leaders of his time, earning the title Ishwish because of his tremendous understanding of the spiritual laws. He could see that the future held great devastation for the people who followed him if they stayed there, so he decided to flee the Pleiades and look for a place of safety and refuge. Upon making his decision to leave, he was followed by 70,000 people, including 200 scientists, and fled the wars which were bringing death to so many. It was known to Pelagon that Earth could support life similar to the home planets and was largely uninhabited at the time. Fleeing the tyranny and death that always seemed to follow the Lyran family, he led his people on a quiet and peaceful Earth to start a new life. As the Earth grew under the leadership of Pelagon's 200 appointed sub-leaders, the worst war of all time was still raging on the home worlds. But under Pelagon's leadership and the guidance of his lieutenants, they populated the many continents of Earth and created a society of love and spiritual growth. Life was flourishing and peaceful as Pelagon was good to his people. He taught them the ways of spirit and how life should be lived by observing the laws of creation. This was a society built on spiritual knowledge instead of material greed and power, and it was working. The true natives of Earth, the brown-skinned race, were in awe of the great power of the Ishwish, Pelagon. They were very underdeveloped in comparison to the settlers from the stars, but lived in harmony and peace with them, and Pelagon treated them with respect and love. A master of the knowledge of material life through the development of spirit, Pelagon's seemingly magical abilities caused many stories among the Earthlings, which told of his abilities to rule over life and death. One story was passed on that he was once seen floating in air, held up by the power of his mind, and by casting a look at a small tree, he caused it to grow. Because of the great power over life and death the Earth people believed he possessed, they called him God, generating the idea that God was a man who held power over life and death. It was Pelagon who became the first God image on Earth, thus starting the concept that we were created in his image. Finally, in the Pleiades the spiritual leaders were able to overtake the scientists, and peace reigned at last. The people learned to trust in the truths of creation and the knowledge and wisdom of the spiritual laws. This is a normal process in the development of most races, for in the beginning stages of development man lives entirely by material sense and thinking. And then as he evolves through numerous lifetimes, he slowly learns that he is more than just a physical being and begins to solve the problems of life with more spiritual solutions. At a certain point in the development of a race, enough people advance spiritually, and the old material ways of force and power give way to the more spiritual ways of love and light. With this kind of shift in consciousness, societies experience monumental change. This change came to the Pleiadians, and over the next 8,000 years they developed themselves to a very high spiritual level, and they were at last able to leave behind the long legacy of war and bloodshed of their Lyran past. They still live by those peaceful standards today. Nothing was known on Earth of the peace in the Pleiades. Pelagon is still ruler and for the first time in 300,000 years, Earth was living peacefully and happy. The force of his spirit allowed him to live for 4,000 years, during which time he guided the planet to a degree of spiritual development that surpassed anything known in Lyran history. His vision of life helped this great civilization last for almost 10,000 years before a new Ishwish by the name of Jesses came into power. Jesses lacked the morals and knowledge of Pelagon and began to rule through power and control over others. He had only ruled for 20 years before the people would no longer stand for their world being ruined, they rose up against him, causing war to break out again. After living for thousands of years in peace caused by the love of the great Pelagon, the people wanted no part in a world of war. So, by the hundreds of thousands they fled to a nearby star system known as Beta Centauri, leaving behind a war that brought total destruction to Earth. 31,000 BC, Atlantis and Mu. There are few myths or fables that capture the imagination of man more than the story of ancient Atlantis. If it really existed, what happened to it, and why is there no trace of its existence? Stories have been passed down for centuries about the huge island continent that existed between what today is called Africa and South America, a place where our forefathers lived in a society even more advanced than ours and traveled the stars. As an example of how Pleiadian technology can change fable to fact, here is the true story of Atlantis and our connection to it. After the great exodus to the planets in the Beta Centauri area and the destruction of life on Earth, there was a span of 7,000 years when travelers avoided coming here. The only life to be found was a few scattered tribes of brown-skinned humans who lived in primitive huts. They were the original Earth inhabitants, who were still very underdeveloped, and were of no interest to the star travelers. Gone was the technology of the great society of Pelagon that had raised the consciousness of man to new heights. The Earth had fallen into a time of darkness and despair. Light years away lived the descendants of those who had fled the Earth thousands of years ago. Here in the Barnard star system, a society of human life flourished and lived peacefully. After all, they were the sons and daughters of the great Pelagon, who had taught them how to live in peace and harmony with creation. This rich heritage provided them with a spiritual advancement that left behind the cries of war and the struggle for power, and created a world of peace and spiritual growth. Among the leaders was a kind and generous Ishwish named Atlant. He was a tall, blonde-haired, broad-shouldered man of obvious Lyran descent. His bright blue eyes and pale white skin painted a picture not unlike his Lyran ancestors of millions of years ago. He was very popular, and although life there was peaceful and happy, he longed to lead his followers to a now world where they could start a life full of adventure and growth. There were many who decided to follow Atlant, and plans were made to migrate to Earth, a small planet their ancestors had lived on that was hospitable to human life. Here they could create a whole new world. At first only a few came and found the Earth to be rough and untamed. After piloting their great ships over most of the Earth's surface, they decided to build their first city on a large continent located just above the line of the equator, which had a warm climate good for living. Having lived peacefully for thousands of years, their technology had developed to a very high state, so it was only a very short time before the beautiful architecture of the star travelers began to fill the horizon. As the city grew and word reached back to the home planets of the success of their new home, thousands more left the Barnard system and came to Earth. Within only a few short years, the Great Society, named after its leader Atlant, had populated a large area of the planet. There are seven basic colors of humanity in the universe: white, brown, red, yellow, blue, green, and black. Six are represented on Earth. Based on our current calendar, the beginnings of Atlantis would be around 31,000 BC. Some history of this event still rests with the American Indians and some other races, which have for years passed down the story of the Great Atlantis. The people of Atlantis were kind and generous and lived peacefully with the inhabitants of Earth. Although the Earthlings were far less developed, they were accepted into their cities and found jobs and encouragement, for no hate or prejudice existed in the minds of these spiritually developed travelers from the stars. Atlant had a wife named Caryatidae, who was also ambitious and well thought of as a leader. She helped spread the civilization to new parts of the planet, founding cities around an area that today we call the Mediterranean. These smaller satellite cities were called Little Atlantis and lived under the same peaceful rule as the large cities. Caryatidae had a father named Mures. He was a powerful leader from the Lyran chain of families. After the successful beginnings of Atlantis, he came to Earth with thousands of his followers and built a city on the opposite side of the planet called Mu. Named after its founder, Mu grew to be a gigantic city. It slowly spread out and founded other parts of the planet. After many years, the many cities that fell under the rule of Mures became known as the Kingdom of Lemuria. Mu was situated in the area we now call the Gobi Desert, which is an area between China and Russia. As the Great Society of Mu advanced, they built two underground cities called Agartha Alpha and Agartha Beta, located directly below Mu. The cities were connected together by underground tube systems which ran for hundreds of miles, carrying the citizens of Mu from one town to another. Eventually, even more underground tube systems were built and connected many areas of Earth. Although most of these underground tunnels have been destroyed over the years, some of them still exist today. Thousands of years of peaceful living on Earth produced the largest population ever to live here. Almost the entire planet was populated with cities on every continent that boasted a high quality of living and technology, Earth became known as a peaceful and tranquil place to live, attracting travelers from many different parts of the galaxy. Pleiadian history is not completely accurate here, but it is believed that as many as 8 more races from different worlds came to Earth during this time and blended in with the great societies of Atlantis and Mu. From the star called Sirius came a race of black humans who were very highly developed. They were not of the Lyran chain, but boasted a high spiritual level. They found it easy to live in peace with the artistic and creative people of Atlantis. Other humans came from the stars of Orion, Vega, and Hyades, who were also descendants of the ancient Lyrans. It was also during this time that a race arrived and started a new colony on Earth whose origins are still not known. They were an older race than the Lyrans and kept to themselves and were very peaceful. These were the colonies that founded the Asian communities on Earth, a different family of origin, but now part of the ever-changing mixture of the new Earthman. The Earth was becoming a melting pot of races and colors who lived together in peace and love. 16,000 B.C. Exile to Beta Centauri. For 15,000 years the Earth lived in peace, the longest time for any civilization to ever make it here. It was a time of spiritual growth and development for all who shared the Earth. But as things would go, trouble started when a group of young scientists, bent on controlling others, tries to cause problems. Hungry for power, the peace of Earth was threatened for the first time in thousands of years. Fortunately, the people recognized the potential trouble and drove the scientists off of the planet. They fled into space towards a star called Beta Centauri, the closest sun system to Earth, located just 4.3 light years away. Here they found human life on a planet and lived in exile. For 2,000 years, these same exiled scientists and their followers schemed for revenge, while they built up great power and increased their lifespan. Because of their hatred for the rulers of Earth, they plotted to return and seek revenge and eventually attacked Earth. They were led by the Ishwish, Arus, who intended to destroy Atlantis and Mu. Robbing, murdering, but only able to take over small regions of land, they settled in the northern area called Hyperborea, which is today known as Florida. The Earth had not suffered through its axis shift yet, so Hyperborea was still north of the equator. This is the end of Part 5. For more information about the Pleiadian mission, please visit thepleiadianmission.com. Again, please visit thepleiadianmission.com. Also subscribe and share this video. Let the whole world know the truth. Thank you for listening. Remember that knowledge is power. Please, don't be left in the dark. Please continue to Part 6 in the next video.